Top the peak stands he, waving his freedom, waving his rose. His clothes, they're made in grand laughter. He inherits them not a moment before, nor a moment after. Lulling before him howls his spirit, right into the wind, the letters of his very own words. Just before taking seven steps forward into the kingdom of earth, where in a garden he stands, and before him lies the table at hand. He's busily picking up on the elements and the shape of the pentagram. He wants to be certain that he has his way with his new lover. She's called Beth. She wears an arbor of red roses. She wears a star-studded vest. She sits with the moon beneath her feet. Her letter T is embroidered to her dress. She's serenely awaiting the decisions of light and darkness so that she's able to give birth. She wants to lay back and spread her legs, thus giving passage to the return of the sage, who, despite his old age, is busily engaged in setting things to order. And it's at this stage he realizes 'tis he who is author, producer, composer, transformer, begetter, and inventor of the maze. 'Tis he. Well, and he's shouting out his whispers from the very center of his cube. While he furnishes the missing links, he replaces the blown-out tubes for those who stand before him patiently awaiting the breeze. It's there they reconcile their differences before he hands to them keys which unlock the door of dominion over the forest of trees. And where he clearly sees, 'tis what he hears which will lead him through the mystery. Once there, he stumbles upon a set of babes. They are nestled near their mother's breasts. Why they're touching one another gently, but in his drowsiness, he's unable to perceive just what is going on, though trying his very best. But nevertheless, for the very next moment, this despite himself and everything, it comes to him in a red package. The nature of their relationship and their names. And soon he discovers why the only way to keep from going plumb insane is to stand quietly observing the nature of Eve and Adam's game. Takes him dashing in a car bound to a flash, whose intimacy leaves him laughing hysterically and reaching for the crotch of his pants and standing before the city of his conquered foe. His crown of seven stars upon his head is all aglow, for he's rendered captivity captive. He uses its forces below. Well, his life is particularly active. He's doing what he knows will, in and of itself, become his very freedom and safety from unnumbered foe. As he waves goodbye to everything in sight, up to and including his war-torn clothes. For he knows he's only the time for being and becoming, yes, and falling in love with the woman who, while wearing white, tames her mountain lion running to the mountain slopes above. And where, waving his wand of intuition, yes, and frantically retracing every step he's ever made, he carves circular figures in the ice while sipping 10-cent lemonade that he just bought from a most gorgeous young girl. She sits with in one hand her sword and in her face a curl. Well, and in her other hand she holds her scales upon which she weighs all of her limbs before going to play with her good friend and playmate, who otherwise happily spends his day hanging by his feet, upside down in a tree, passionately observing the young girl's ways. For he knows that surely all things will pass. It's there where he tempers the elements of present, future, and past. It is also there where at last his eyes penetrate the veil of appearance knitted and like villains cast. With a merely confused conception, yes, an hour searching for the truth. Well, their lies are downright deception. They may as well be stomping upon your boots, or what's worse, putting a gun to your head, which immediately shoots. It's far better lying beneath the moon with his memory slipping from its grave while repairing his old Model T, the former slave. When something comes along his way that he not long ago gave, and this as a strong indication of the salvation from the tomb to which he'd been laid. For the freedom of a magic dancer who, clad scantily in a braid, stands tiptoe upon a quarter. She's observing the world she'd made. Why, she's balanced by the motion of motion itself. She's feeling and acting as if she'd been saved. And I kind of get the notion from having said all this that there really is nothing else.